And it's done.
Put your face in the mountain.
Please help.
Can start now.
I'm calling.
Okay, good afternoon everybody. Today's topic for microbiology practical classes, sample collection and transport. So let us start our class with why do we have to collect samples for any patient? When patients come to us and presenting with some certain symptoms, you will suspect certain conditions, whether the patient has any infection or not. So when the patient has any infection, then you'll have certain differential diagnosis in certain conditions causing different kind of different infections. So in different infections, you'll collect different samples to ensure the proper diagnosis and to give the patient proper treatment so that he gets cured. So when do you collect samples, and why do you collect samples, and how do you collect any sample? So usually for collecting the samples, samples should be collected before starting any antimicrobial therapy. So that will be the ideal condition, so that the appropriate organisms can be isolated and can be treated properly. So what are the various samples that can be collected for various infections? For your urinary tract infections, you'll collect urine samples, and for respiratory infections, there are various samples that can be collected, like sputum, BAL, mini BAL, endotracheal aspirate, nasal swab, throat swab, etc. And blood samples for other systemic infections, certain sterile body fluids like CSF or CNS infections, and pleural fluid, ascitic or peritoneal fluid, etc. And for enteric infections, you'll collect stool samples, and for other skin infections or wound infections, you'll collect pus samples and swabs from wound sites. And then for other skin and nail infections, you'll collect skin scrapings, nail clippings, and epilated hairs. And in certain conditions where you cannot collect all the samples, or all the above samples cannot give you any diagnostic diagnosis, then we'll go for tissue biopsies. And for genital infections, we can collect urethral swabs, vaginal swabs, and endocervical swabs, etc. So ideally, all the samples should be collected before starting any antimicrobial therapy. So after collection, how in which container do you collect a sample is of utmost importance. You should have you should collect the sample in a sterile container which is tightly screw capped and wide mouth for most of the conditions, along with the ideal requisition form with all the patient details filled in it. So what does the ideal requisition form include? It has, it should have the details of patient, which are like name, age, sex, address, and his IPD or OPD number, and from which ward you are sending, and time and date of sample collection, and the nature of specimen, a little clinical history of the patient, and the provisional diagnosis. Then investigation needed for that particular sample, and then signature of the resident or consultant. So without any of these details on the form, the sample cannot be received or it can be rejected. So what are the different criteria for rejecting the samples? First of all, there shouldn't be any mismatch of information on the label and on the request. The sample collecting container should also be labeled with the patient details and the details on the sample vial, and also the requisition form should match. And then when there is inappropriate transport temperature, and when there is excessive delay in transportation, inappropriate transport medium, and when the specimen is dry, and when sample is with questionable relevance. That means if you are sending some sample which doesn't yield the required diagnosis for a certain condition, then insufficient quantity, and when there is sample leakage. So these are the major criteria for rejecting the samples. So we will now go in detail about how all the different samples are collected and transported to the laboratory. Now we'll start with urine sample. Dr. Shruti will explain you about urine sample collection and transport. So I'll hand over to Shruti.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Shruti J.R., microbiology, and I'll be talking about urine and respiratory sample collection and transportation. So before going into the spots, we'll first discuss a few things about urine and respiratory samples. So coming to the urine sample collection, what are all the scenarios? First scenario is patient is normal, and so we'll be collecting the urine. So mostly what we'll do is, we'll collect an early morning midstream urine. Midstream urine is like first few ml. First we'll wash the we'll ask the patient to wash the external genitalia with water, and then for ask the patient to leave few ml of urine to pass away, and then catch the midstream urine. Okay, this is first step. And next is, if the patient is having some other pathology like prostate cancer or a prostate hypertrophy or an external genitalia malignancy, where the external or out, I mean the output is blocked, in that case the urine will be collected inside the bladder. So how to collect that time? So there is a thing called straight catheter collection. What we do is, we take a catheter, we pass it inside the urethra till the urinary bladder, and we'll allow for 15 to 20 ml of the urine to pass out of the catheter, and then collect it with the wide mouth sterile screw cap leak proof container. Okay, next is, this is for the patient. Now we are putting the catheter. Next is, if a patient is already having a catheter, indwelling catheter, that time how do we collect is, first we'll have to clamp the catheter just behind the port, and then leave the clamp intact for around 30 minutes, and wait for the urine to be collected in the for catheter just behind the clamp. After 30 minutes, what we do is, we'll have to clean the catheter with 70% isopropyl alcohol, then take a syringe and insert it at 30 degree angle, and then withdraw the sample and collect it in the the container. Okay, transporting container. Next is, this is for the catheter. Next we'll come to the invasive procedure, which is the suprapubic aspiration. What is suprapubic aspiration? Where we commonly do it is in infants and in elderly people, we generally do it. So how it is done? What is suprapubic aspiration? By, as the name suggests, just above the pubis, we are inserting the syringe and aspirating it. Generally, this urinary bladder, it is a pelvic organ. Okay. So how do we collect it? This urinary bladder has to be filled with urine. It has to be completely filled, and it will just pop out of the pelvis. At that time, either with the ultrasound guidance or by tapping with the dull node percussions, we'll have to find the urinary bladder above the pubis, and then percutaneously first we'll have to clean and put a nick, and through the nick we'll have to insert an 18 gauge needle directed towards the urinary bladder and then suck the urine out. And finally, this nephrostomy. What is nephrostomy? Nephrostomy is like in some pathology, like malignancies where the urethra, I mean the ureters are like blocked, where the urine from the kidneys are formed but it's not able to reach the bladder. That time the hydronephrosis will happen, there will be urine collected in the kidneys. So to take out that urine, what they do is percutaneously they will insert a nephrostomy tube through to the kidneys, and the urine from the kidneys will be collected into a bag which is placed outside the found attached to the abdomen or to the thighs. And from so for this situation, how do we collect this? We'll have to collect it directly from the bag. We should make sure that the tip of the bag and the tip of the container does not touch each other, and we'll have to collect it. Other than this situation, nowhere else we'll have to collect directly from the urinary bag. With this we should remember. Next, coming to the respiratory samples. So, okay, the urine is now collected. How do we transport this? Generally, it has to be transported within 2 hours. And if a delay of more than 5 hours is anticipated, then the sample is to be discarded. It is of no use. And if more delay is anticipated, that time, what we can do is either we can keep it in 4 degrees Celsius for up to 24 hours, or we can add some preservatives like boric acid to preserve it, okay, and then use it within 24 hours. After 24 hours, even after adding preservative or keeping at 4 degrees Celsius, is of no use. Okay. Next coming to the respiratory samples. Okay, respiratory samples, how do we divide us? Upper respiratory, okay, how respiratory tract is upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract. So for upper respiratory tract, what are all the samples we can consider is a nasal swab, a throat swab, a nasopharyngeal swab, a nasopharyngeal aspirate, nasopharyngeal wash, and throat swab, as I already told. Next, coming to the lower respiratory tract, what are all the samples that can be considered? It can be a sputum, or it can be a ball, or it can be a lung biopsy. Okay, final thing is the lung biopsy, more invasive one. So when it is viral, when we are expecting a viral cause, that time the most commonly the sample we take is of an upper respiratory tract sample, especially even for now in COVID situation, what we are taking is a nasopharyngeal swab. Why do we take a nasopharyngeal swab? The virus, most of the viruses, they replicate in the ciliated columnar epithelium of the nasopharynx. So that is the most valued sample. Which is more valued than nasopharyngeal swab is a nasopharyngeal wash or a nasopharyngeal aspirate. Okay, so how do we collect a nasopharyngeal aspirate? We'll have to take a syringe attached with the catheter. We'll have to pass through the nostrils till the posterior end, and we'll have to apply the suction and while taking it out, and put the sample in the viral transport media. This is for nasopharyngeal aspirate. Then nasopharyngeal wash, same, except for like we'll have to instill few ml of sterile saline inside, and we have to take it out. Though nasopharyngeal wash is kind of cumbersome, it has higher yield. Okay. So next is the nasopharyngeal swab. How do we collect a nasopharyngeal swab? We'll just inform the patient what we are going to do first. Next, through the nostrils, we'll insert the swab inside till the posterior end, till we find the resistance there. We'll have to rotate it multiple times, leave it there for a few seconds, and then take it out and put it in the transport media. This is for nasopharyngeal swab. Then for oropharyngeal swab, how do you take? We'll have to ask the patient to open the mouth. We'll have to sit in such a way that the light source comes from our head, behind our head, and it falls directly on patient's mouth. And we'll have to start collecting the sample from this end, I mean any one end, and arch it towards the other end. We'll have to make sure that we are collecting, I mean touching the anterior pillar, posterior pillar, the fossa, and here the anterior pillar, posterior pillar, fossa, and finally we'll have to also touch the posterior pharyngeal wall. We should be like sure that we are not touching the uvula and other areas of other areas in the mouth. And if any exudates or inflamed area is seen, we should make sure that we are touching these areas as well. Okay, this is for oral swab. So we are talking these much things about swab. So what is a swab? Which swab is to be considered when that is coming under consideration? First is the for viral. Most commonly we take a Dacron swab or a nylon swab or a rayon swab. This is mostly considered. Which is not accepted is a calcium alginate swab and a cotton swab. Okay, these contain inhibiting material. Also the shaft. The shaft is also very important. When this for which is considered is a plastic swab, plastic shaft or a plastic shaft or an aluminium shaft is also considered. Whereas which is not considered is a wooden shaft, because these materials contain inhibitory substances that will lyse the nucleic acid. So which finally the yield won't be there. We won't be able to find get the result in the PCR. That's why those things are avoided. Also, this calcium alginate has a tendency to fluorescence. So it will also give negative results and all of also false positive results. So we are not taking these. Okay. And there is a flocked swab. What is flocked swab is? It's also a nylon swab with nylon fibers arranged like a brush. It has more surface area. It will yield more material. And finally, releasing the material into the VTM also happens best with this flocked swab. So this is good. Okay. And so now the upper respiratory tract sample is over. Coming to the lower respiratory tract sample. Lower respiratory tract sample first is the sputum. Sputum is a lower respiratory tract sample that we should have in our mind. And so how do we collect a sputum sample? Early morning. First is the early morning first sample. Second is we'll have to ask the patient to wash the mouth with water to take away the extra oral microbiota. And we'll have to ask the patient to take a deep cough and cough out this expectorant directly into the wide mouth screw capped container. We'll have to make sure that the material does not pass through the oral, I mean does not touch the oral cavity much. And after sending it this way, we'll have to make sure whether it is appropriate or not. How do we understand that whether it's appropriate or not? What we'll have to do is, there is a criteria by name of Washington Muller's criteria. There we'll have to stain and make a smear of the sputum and see it under the microscope. There we will see, we should see less than 10 cells of epithelial cells per low power field and more than 25 pus cells, that is the neutrophils, per low power field. If these both criteria are met, then only we consider the sample as appropriate. Otherwise the sample is not considered as appropriate. Okay, so this much is for sputum. Okay, if a patient is not able to expectorate, then what do we do? Then at that time the term called as induced sputum come into play. Like what do we do is, we'll ask the patient to as usual wash the mouth with water and then nebulize the patient with 10-30% of sterile saline. Okay, then that will induce cough and induce sputum in such patient. So such a sample will be looking like saliva. It will be watery. It won't be looking like normal sputum. So mentioning about the induced sputum in the sheet is very, very important. And these Washington Muller's criteria, they know that won't hold good for this induced sputum. Okay. Then next is the BAL. Okay, as we all know, BAL is an invasive sample first. Second thing, how do it? We take a flexible bronchoscope and we enter into a particular segment where we are suspecting the organisms to be lodged. There the water is, I mean sterile saline is flushed and it is aspirated back and it is sent to the lab. So what is the time period? Less than 2 hours, it can be kept in room temperature if we are suspecting a bacterial etiology. If any viral etiology is suspected, then immediately viral transport media, it has to be used and 4 degrees temperature has to be maintained throughout the transport and after the transport as well. Okay. Now we'll quickly read through the slides, what is all there. Coming to the urine sample collection, the preferred sample is clean voided midstream urine sample. So before sample collection in men, what do we do? Prepuce is retracted, glans penis is cleaned with wet cotton, and in women cleaned properly with soap and water. Suprapubic cystostomy sample may be necessary in children and elderly, as I already told, and transport to the lab without delay, else refrigerate. Do not collect samples from the urobags. Urobags never considered except in nephrostomy patients. Okay. And collection from the catheter. Patient is informed about, the indwelling catheter, this is. Patient is informed about the procedure and taken consent. After wearing the gloves, the tubing of the catheter is clamped. It is allowed to stand for 30 minutes for urine to collect till the level of clamp. Area proximal to the clamp is disinfected by 70% isopropyl alcohol. With 20 ml syringe of 22 to 25 gauge needle, urine is collected and then transferred to a wide mouth screw capped container. Transported to the laboratory and processed within 1 to 2 hours. Remove the clamp after the procedure. Okay, the same thing is explained here. This is the port. Before this port, here we have to clamp it, and just behind the clamp, here they have clamped it. So just here, proximal to the clamp, we'll have to wipe it with 70% isopropyl alcohol, and then we'll have to take the sample. So this is the nephrostomy tube collection. So as I already told, what all the conditions where with the nephrostomy is done is hydronephrosis, calculi, malignancies, fistulas, non-dilated obstructive uropathy, decompression of nephric, when a decompression of nephric or a perinephric abscess is required, or for administration of drugs directly into the kidney. Okay. So procedure is first, how do we collect it? As I already told, the urinary bag will be attached to the abdomen. That has to be taken out, and we have to facilitate the gravity. Now the urinary bag should be kept at the lower level than that of kidneys. When sufficient volume of urine has collected, open the drainage bag valve and drain it into the sterile collection cup without allowing the tip of the bag to touch inside the cup. Okay, then close the drainage valve, prepare and label this specimen, and do not aspirate from the urinary bag. Never aspirate from the urinary bag. Next is the invasive urinary sample collection. Here, suprapubic aspiration, when all it is indicated. First is neonates and children less than 2 years, can cancer, prostate or hypertrophy of prostate, gynecological malignancies, spinal cord injury where the patient is not able to void the urine, and chronic infection of periurethral glands and urethra, and phimosis, urethral trauma, urethral suture, where all the patient, it's like obstruction to the flow of the urine. Okay, so procedure, bladder must be full, and then localize the bladder by dull note of percussion or ultrasound. Sterilize the area with povidone iodine and 70% ethyl alcohol. Palpate the pubic symphysis. Inject the local anesthetic 1% lidocaine subcutaneously 2 cm above the superior border of the pubic symphysis. A small incision is made by sharp tapered end of the surgical blade, and then through the incision, an 18 gauge short bevel spinal needle is inserted into the urinary bladder. Then 10 to 20 ml of urine is aspirated through the syringe. And how do we transport? The sample must be transported by 1 to 2 hours and plated by within 4 to 5 hours. Okay, and if there is any delay anticipated, refrigerate at 4 degrees up to 24 hours, or add preservatives like boric acid 1.8%, glycerol, sodium formate, which act as bacteriostatic agents. It will allow the bacteria to be alive, but it won't allow the commensals to overgrow the pathogenic organisms. That is the main concept. If there is a delay more than 5 hours, discard the sample. So coming to the respiratory samples, so here, when we are collecting a throat swab and we are expecting a bacterial etiology, that time this spikes media and crystal violet impregnated filter paper will act as transport media. Okay, this crystal violet present in this both media will inhibit the growth of other commensals. So how do we take a oral swab is, first ask the patient to open the mouth and explain the procedure. They take a tongue depressor, depress it, start from the same and touch the, make sure you are touching the anterior pillar, posterior pillar, fossae, and this side anterior pillar, posterior pillar, fossae, any inflamed area, any exudates, posterior pharyngeal wall, and then you should make sure that you are not touching any other surface inside the mouth. So criteria for sputum acceptability, when can we accept the sample? Okay, first, unlabeled specimen container, never, do not accept it. Okay, saliva, if nasopharyngeal secretions are there, no, should not accept it. Early morning sputum is the preferred sample. Why? Because overnight the patient has not coughed, he was sleeping. So all the organisms tend to get accumulated. So the yield will be there, more concentrated the organism load will be. Okay. Next is the 24 hours collection of sputum sample. It is not accepted because when we are spitting out the saliva and the sputum and is collected outside, the normal flora will also be present, which will overgrow the pathogenic organism. So finally you won't get the pathogenic organism growth only. So next is the epithelial cells. As I already told, epithelial cells should be less than 10 per low power field and pus cells should be more than 25 per low power field. Okay, this is the same the Washington Murray's criteria, where epithelial cells should be less than 10 per low power field and pus cells should be more than 25 per low power field. This criteria holds good, and we are considering this criteria only for normal bacteria. When there is induced sputum or when we are looking for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, Legionella, Mycoplasma, and all these criteria, and all we are not seeing. Okay, next is how do we collect it and watch which container, how do we transport it? Ball, mini ball, or bronchial washings, tracheal aspirate, sputum and induced sputum, for everything, how do we collect and transport? Sterile, screw capped, wide mouth, leak proof container we are collecting. Okay, and it should be transported less than 2 hours. If more than 24 hours, up to 24 hours, more than 2 hours, up to 24 hours, 4 degrees we can keep, and we are plating it into blood agar, meconium agar and chocolate agar. For fastidious organisms, we are considering chocolate agar. Okay, it's more enriched, so more growth, better growth will be there. Then gram stain has to be done, and finally culture has to be done. This is endotracheal aspirate. How do we collect? Now already the patient is an endotracheal tube. Okay, that time how do we collect this is, we'll have a Lucan's trap. This is the Lucan's trap, where niche we'll have to fit the specimens jar, sterile specimen jar. Okay, and this trap, one end is connected to the endotracheal tube and the other end is connected to the vacuum source, and this the secretions, when the vacuum is switched on, the secretions from the endotracheal tube is taken and collected inside the specimen jar. Okay, and this is the bronchoalveolar lavage. This is required for deep sampling of desquamated host cells and secretions, especially suitable for detecting pneumosis and fungal elements. These, for fungal elements and pneumosis, generally won't like the yield will be very less when we are considering sputum sample. So when ball is considered, the yield will be good. Okay, high volume of saline, 100 to 300 ml is infused into the lung segment through the bronchoscope to obtain the cells and proteins of the pulmonary interstitium and alveolar spaces. Okay, mini ball means not 100 to 300 ml, 20 ml is infused. This is how they take the nasopharyngeal aspirate. As I already told, the syringe is attached to a rubber tube, flexible catheter, and it is inserted through the nostrils till you feel the resistance, and you take it back while withdrawing it. Okay, this is nasopharyngeal aspirate. Next is the swab, nasal swab. Nasal swab is of two types, pre-nasal swab, post-nasal swab. The main difference is, in pre-nasal swab, we will be inserting it through the anterior nares, while the post-nasal swab, we are inserting it through the mouth. Okay, pre-nasal swab. Use a calcium alginate or dicron fiber tip swab on a fine flexible wire. Gently pass the swab through the nostril to the posterior nasopharynx. Rotate the swab and leave it in place for up to 30 seconds until the patient coughs. Post-nasal swab is a vis, post-nasal swab, a swab is there, that only we are using, is passed through the mouth to reach the posterior nasopharynx. Okay, salivary contamination should be avoided. Anyway, whatever it is, we have to avoid the salivary contamination. And nasopharyngeal aspirate. So nasopharyngeal aspirate, as I already told, it is the best sample for PCR, as alginate swab and aluminum shaft inhibit the PCR. Plate, bedside or bordered gengo, glycerin, potato, blood agar is there. That is actually for mainly this suggested for this what to say, whooping cough. For whooping cough, the plate is given to the mother to home, and whenever the baby is having a paroxysm, that time the plate is asked to keep in front of the patient's mouth so that they will be coughing out and the organism will be directly deposited onto the plate, so that in the plate itself will act as a transport media as well. Okay, so what are the transport media? 0.5 to 1% casein cas amino acid solution if it is less than 2 hours, and if more than 2 hours and less than 24 hours transport time is anticipated, that time amice medium is used, and for more than 24 hours Regan Lewis transport medium is used. Next, and handing it to Dr. Sauzina ma'am, she will be continuing.
So after discussing about urine sample collection and respiratory samples collection, now we'll move on to blood sample collection for blood cultures. So the amount of blood that we collect for culture is different in different age groups. So in infants we collect 0.5 to 2 ml of blood, and in children we collect 2 to 5 ml of blood, and in adults we'll have to collect 5 to 10 ml of blood. So how do we collect blood samples for cultures? Usually we have to follow aseptic technique, which is a three layer technique. We'll have to choose the vein site for venipuncture, and then apply a layer of chlorhexidine, and then followed by betadine or tincture iodine, and then again a third layer of chlorhexidine. This we have to do from center to periphery, and then insert your needle and syringe with the vacutainer, and then collect the sample. Here to follow this three layer technique, the goal is to avoid contamination, because even skin has flora which will be collected if proper aseptic techniques are not followed. So then we should never collect samples from indwelling catheters. The vein from which blood is to be drawn must be chosen before the skin is disinfected, and then if required, even the gloved hands has to be disinfected using sterilium. Then if a patient has an existing IV line, then the blood has to be drawn below the IV line. So blood drawn above the line will be diluted with the fluids that are being infused by the IV line. So after collecting blood, we'll have to transfer the blood into the blood culture bottles, either the conventional blood culture bottle or the Bactec bottle. Then sterile body fluids. For CNS infections, we'll have to collect a CSF sample, which has to be collected in a fresh sterile screw capped container. For this, a lumbar puncture has to be done, which is done by physician following aseptic precautions. Then after collection of CSF sample, it has to be transported to the lab immediately, because delay may lead to the death of delicate pathogens like meningococcus and other leukocytes, which may disintegrate. So when delay is suspected, it can be stored at room temperature for not more than 24 hours, but should be never refrigerated, because the lower temperatures will kill the Haemophilus influenzae organism. So how do we collect the CSF? Here the physician will collect the CSF sample from L3, L4 or L4, L5 lumbar vertebrae into a labeled sterile container. about 5 to 10 ml of CSF sample has to be collected. Your more volume of CSF collection may lead to headache. That's why a large volume of CSF is not collected. A minimum of 5 ml is sufficient for various investigations to be sent. So the fluid is to be collected at a rate of 4 to 5 drops per second. Even a higher rate of sample collection will also lead to headache. So this is the ideal rate at which the sample has to be collected. And here the CSF sample has to be collected in three containers, in three parts. The first fraction of sample that has to be collected will be sent for biochemical investigations. And then middle fraction will be sent for microbiological investigations. And then for the third final fraction will be sent for cytological investigations. So for ear infections, otitis, what are the different samples that we collect here? Either a pus sample or a drainage fluid sample can be collected. So for external ear infection and for middle ear infections, we can collect tympanocentesis fluid or aspiration from middle ear, or even nasopharyngeal swab will suffice in certain conditions. So how do we collect these ear samples? From in external ear infections, a pus swab will be sufficient in most of the cases, but when we need drainage fluid, and then the external ear is cleaned with 1:1000 benzalkonium chloride, and then it is dried properly before collecting tympanocentesis sample, and also it is aspirated aseptically. Then how these samples are transported? Usually they have to be transported within 2 hours at room temperature, and if there is a delay of more than 2 hours to reach the lab, then certain transport media can be used, which are like Stewart's media, Ames media, and RCM thioglycolate broth and CO2 oil. These are anaerobic transport media. Then for sinusitis, we collect various samples like sinus washings and surgical biopsy specimens. So usually sinus washings are not recommended. Biopsy specimen is considered gold standard. So these are surgically collected under aseptic condition and transported within 2 hours at room temperature, and also for anaerobic investigations. If there is a delay of more than 2 hours, then transport media are used. For eye infections, conjunctival infections, the purulent material from the surface of lower conjunctival sac and inner canthus, inner angle of the eye, is collected using a sterile swab and is sent for culture. Both eyes should be cultured separately. And in a patient with keratitis, an ophthalmologist collects scrapings of the cornea with a heat sterilized platinum spatula, and these scrapings are sent to lab immediately for culture. Then coming to genital tract infections, and what are the different samples that we collect for genital tract infections? So in vaginitis or vaginosis or uterine sepsis, to diagnose these conditions, we'll have to collect a high vaginal swab. And how is this collected? Using a vaginal speculum, we insert the vaginal speculum and then put the swab is inserted into the upper part of the vagina and rotated before withdrawing it. So this makes a high vaginal swab, and by doing culture and gram stain, the diagnosis that the organism causative for vaginitis or vaginosis can be diagnosed. Then in gonorrhea, an endocervical swab must be collected for examination for gonococci. So here also a vaginal speculum must be used to provide a clear sight of cervix, and the swab is rubbed in and around the introitus of cervix and then withdrawn without contamination from vaginal wall. So this is the endocervical swab which will be taken from the introitus of cervix. Then gonococcus infection in men. Here this specimen is collected by milking the urethra, and the urethral discharge is smeared on slides and then inoculated on warmed plates of heated blood agar or selective medium for isolation of gonococci. So the main sample here is urethral discharge. And coming to wound, skin and deep infections. For wound and skin infections, the most commonly collected sample is the wound swab. And in certain cases where the pus discharge is more than pus aspirate, pus sample can be collected in a sterile wide mouth screw capped container. So ideally when exudates can be collected, then pus swab can be avoided because it will collect even the floor of the skin. Then ideal samples from wounds. As I said, it is pus or exudates, and it should be submitted in a small screw capped bottle in firmly stoppered tube or syringe or a sealed capillary tube. Then fragments of excised tissue which are removed at wound toilet or curettings from infected sinuses and other tissues should be sent in a sterile container. Then coming to stool enteric infections, we'll have to collect stool sample from the patients. And how do we ask the patient to collect stool sample? Only freshly passed stool samples are to be collected without urine getting mixed with this stool sample. And also always avoid stool sample to be collected from a bed pan. And and they should always be collected in a sterile or clean container. Usually the stool sample collecting container will have a small spoon attached to the lid which will help in collecting the stool sample. And you should never clean the container with the disinfectant. And whenever the patient presents with symptoms, it is always better to collect the sample as soon as possible and also within 48 hours of onset of the enteric infection. And a minimum amount should be 5 to 10 ml fresh stool from patients. So the stool sample has to be transported to the laboratory within 2 hours, and if there is any delay of more than 2 hours to reach the lab, then it can be refrigerated at 4 degrees until 24 hours, but never freeze the sample. And if there is more than 24 hours delay, then transport medium can be different transport media can be used, like Stewart's or Ames media. And when you are suspecting certain specific enteric infections like cholera or other enteric infections caused by salmonella or something, when you are strongly suspecting, then transport media like Kerry Blair, alkaline tone water, Venkatraman Ramakrishnan medium, buffered glycerol saline, etc. can be used. So sampling for Vibrio cholerae. In Vibrio cholerae, cholera caused by Vibrio cholerae, usually rice watery stools are produced. So you can either collect the rice watery stool directly, or rectal swabs can be collected. And also you can collect by inserting a lubricated catheter into the rectum, and the liquid stool is allowed to flow directly into a screw capped container. Then rectal swabs provided they are rectal swabs may be used provided they are made with good quality cotton wool, absorbing 0.1 to 0.2 ml of fluid. So these are useful in convalescents who are no longer having watery diarrhea. And when we are suspecting any parasitic infections, parasitic infections, a minimum of 3 stool samples have to be collected on 3 consecutive days of at least 5 to 10 ml of fresh stool, and it has to be transported within 2 hours to the lab. If we are suspecting parasitic infections, any trophozoite movement or anything can be easily detected when the stool sample reaches the lab as soon as possible. The motility can be detected. Then if there is more than 2 hours delay, again it can be stored for 24 hours at 4 degrees centigrade. And then if there is more than 24 hour delay, you can store the samples in certain preservatives like 10% formalin or polyvinyl chloride, in which 3 parts of stool is added to 1 part of the preservative. There are many other preservatives which can be used for stool sample collection and transport, which you'll be explained in detail in parasitic infections class. Then unpreserved samples can be used for antigen detection and PCR of various other tests. Then coming to skin scrapings, skin, hair and nail clippings. These samples are taken for mycological investigations. Usually these samples are collected in black paper. And what is the use of black paper? It is hygroscopic in nature and it absorbs moisture, prevents growth of bacteria. So it also provides a contrast medium for visualization of samples collected like nail clippings and skin scrapings. And then sample collection for diagnosis of viral infections. Various samples can be collected depending on the site of infection. So the sample should be collected at right time from right site and transported in right conditions. So what is the right time? Right time is as soon as possible after patient first presents with symptoms. This applies to all other infections also. And right side means for direct demonstration and isolation. For respiratory infections, nasopharyngeal aspirate, nasal or throat swabs. And then for enteric infections, fecal samples are taken. And then for genital infections, genital swab. For CNS infections, CSF. And for skin infections, vesical scrapings or swab. And also biopsies are ideal. And for serological testing, you'll have to collect blood and separate serum. So that is for today's class. Thank you.
I am not getting no signal here.
I'll take screenshot.
So all in the
door of this, no? I think all this will be. No, this is the system stand of this one. Come. I'm going to make it. 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 I'm going to make it.